channel. It's called Lose Weight With Me. Those of you who use a wheelchair, a walker, a cane, if you have a home care worker, if your knees hurt, if your back hurt, if you have chronic pain, honey, even if you don't have a weight problem, but something is weighing you down, I invite you to come on over here and lose weight with me. And the weight, you might not even have a weight problem. Let's lose what's weighing you down, okay? So we had a wonderful time yesterday, and we're going to have an equally wonderful time today with our special guest, Miss Michelle Pettis. She's the author of this wonderful book. I've been showing y'all this book for months. It's called Leaving Large, and we want her to come in her own way. But I want you to know a few things about Michelle before we get started. She actually has lost and gained over 700 pounds throughout her life. And she has the formula for weight loss success, which she calls telling the story about your weight. So she conducts healing through writing, reading, and storytelling workshops where she teaches others how to find their food and personal truths. She speaks to organizations, large and small, sharing their unique insight, her unique insights, and her story of hope, healing, triumph, and transformation. So, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Michelle Pettis.
Oh, Deborah Ann, thank you. Thank you so much. I am delighted and excited to be here. Thank you so much for sharing this space with me, holding space for this conversation with your audience. This is night number two of a four-part series of finding, facing, and rewriting your food story. And in my challenges, in my struggles to lose weight and keep it off, to gain mastery over emotional overeating, stress eating, yo-yo dieting, binges and cravings, what I figured out, it was my stories that were driving all that behavior. And that when I finally figured out how to connect to myself, I connect to these beliefs, connect to these thoughts, and connect to these stories and rewrite them, I was able to do what I wasn't able to do for 40 years, which was have peace around food, lose weight, and keep it off. And what you said earlier in the introduction was so profound and true, is that, you know, you're holding space for people to talk about their weight, but not just, you know, the body weight, but what's weighing you down. And the reality is, it is our thoughts and our beliefs that are weighing us down. It is our thoughts and our beliefs that are at the source of how we manage food. And there's something that I want to read and I want to share with you. It's not even from my book. It's from another book, but it's so profound. And okay. It speaks to what we're talking about tonight, and where weight comes from, where it comes from. The weight you are seeking to let go was added to your consciousness before it was added to your body. Your body is merely a screen on which is projected the nature of your thoughts. When the weight is gone from your consciousness, it will be gone from your physical experience. When the weight is gone from your consciousness, it will be gone from your physical experience. The way to get it out of your consciousness is through writing and getting to the story. Because we are all subject to these unconscious thoughts and beliefs that drive us to eat without actually even realizing what they are. And once we get aware, once we get conscious, we can look at it, right? And then once we look at it and we realize what it is, then we can rewrite it. I know that we're going to be talking about shame later on in the conversation, but I want to go back to this looking at a situation and rewriting a situation. One of the things that I struggled with for so long was the shame that I felt around the fact that I didn't grow up with my mother. That my mother had me out of wedlock and my grandparents raised me. And I always felt different. I always felt out of step. I felt love, but I but I felt something else. I felt like there was something wrong with me, that there was something innately wrong with me, that there was why my mother didn't want me, why my mother didn't keep me. I felt that for a very long time. And I felt that through the eyes of a kid that didn't understand the world. My thoughts were my thoughts, they were my beliefs, right? But because I had those thoughts, I operated and moved. Because if you, here's the thing, if you believe that your mother doesn't love you, the one person in this world who's going to love you when no one else does, if you at your core believe that, then you believe that you're unlovable to the world and everybody else, if that is your belief, no matter what it may look like on the outside, right? And if your mother doesn't love you, then there must be something horribly wrong with you. Right. That's what I felt. And I felt shame at this horrible wrongness that I didn't even have a name for, couldn't identify. And I couldn't, because there was nothing wrong with me. But here's the thing. Once I got older and I learned of my mother's journey. Right. I went to therapy to be able to step into her shoes. And what I realized was that my mother giving me to her parents to raise was an act of sacrifice and love on her part, that she didn't feel like in the state that she was in that I would be safe. And it was her goal to keep me safe, right, and secure and well taken care of and loved up. And there was nobody on this planet that she knew that could do that better than her parents. And so now, looking back on it is the same situation. It is the same situation. My grandparents raised me. One perspective, I'm ashamed of that fact because I think my mother doesn't love me. Now that I have a new, informed, correct perspective, I understand what an incredible gift she gave me. Right? I'm so appreciative and grateful for that gift because I have understanding. And this is what I'm talking about, and what I'm talking about, rewrite the story. So for years, the story that I carried in my head that caused me pain all the time, right? It wasn't a pain that I could identify. It wasn't a sharp pain. It was just this dull ache of what I felt was not being accepted. And so if you are in pain all the time that you can't even identify, it's just this discomfort you feel, it's just this alienness that you feel, then going to food because it's sweet, because it's pleasurable, because it's a distraction, is a natural thing to do for your own survival, so that your head can be straight, so you can feel better. You, as a kid, you don't have any other, you aren't taught any other coping mechanism, right? Because I grew up with it, you know, with my grandmother, God love her. You got two options when it comes to emotions: happy and happier.
There you go.
I can't tell you the amount of time she will tell me, you're not going to do that. You need to go someplace and make yourself happy.
That's right.
And as a kid, you're kind of limited. But now, as an adult, when I listen to those words and I remember those words, I hear them as empowerment. Because she was saying to me, you are in charge of your own emotional state. You are responsible for your own happiness. Mm-hmm. So go somewhere and figure it out, right? You know,
yeah, my mother said, I'll give you something to cry about. I'll give you something to have access about. Right, that's your option.
That's your option. And so you learn. So I learned to pretend that I was happy when I wasn't.
Exactly.
I learned not to be distracted from, be detached from my feelings, because I knew if I wasn't happy, right, there was gonna be some sort of reprimand. Mm-hmm. And I also now understand that she was saying that to say, you know, don't let the world see your pain, because they'll try to take advantage of that. So no matter what you're feeling, you always gotta present, mm-hmm, right, that you are in a certain space. Otherwise, it'll be misinterpreted and could be used against you. Mm-hmm. I mean, she said all of that to protect me and to make me strong, right?
Yes.
But you don't, but it's not until you get to adulthood that you can understand the nuances of it and understand, you know what, yeah, you can recognize, okay, I'm going to put my happy face on now. I'm pissed, but I'm going to put my happy face on now because I'm going to deal with it. Then I'm going to go do such and such and get it worked out. But right now, right, this is what I'm going to do. So there's a skill around that. But my whole point is the story. Is that for so long I walked around, and we all walk around with these wrong stories in our head that have us eating to cover up the pain of that story. And as soon as we unpack and discover and release the pain of that story and rewrite a new story, then we can be free. Then we can be free. Then we can be free to think about the food. Then we can be free to make some self-honoring choices when we know what our self is, right? Mm-hmm. When we recognize that our self is emotion,
mm-hmm.
right? Our self is every range of emotion, right?
Mm-hmm.
And we need to honor them, honor that as part of our growth, part of how we express ourselves. I mean, mm-hmm. all the stuff that we used to hear about is being, oh, that's a negative emotion, that's a bad emotion. It's not. It's not. Emotions are data. They give us information about the world, how to process the world, and whatever we're feeling is appropriate, right? But because we have to realize that whatever we're feeling, it will pass.
Mm-hmm.
It will pass as we get more information. And it is the same thing, Deborah Ann, about food. Is that, you know, right now we live in a culture, this toxic food environment. And if you heard me once, you've heard me. If you heard me a thousand times, you heard me once, you heard me say it a thousand times. We live in this toxic food culture that has mm-hmm. us eating for everything but hunger.
Yes.
Everything but hunger. And it has us eating everything but food. So mm-hmm. I want to like break that down. Is that, let's talk about food. Just because you can buy it in a what you think is a healthy grocery store doesn't mean that it will not impair your health. We have to be vigilant. We have to be vigilant and understand that. We have to read the labels. We have to go beyond what they tell us about what this is doing to our bodies. Because the processed food industry, the fast food industry, the snack food industry, they do not care about our physical health. All they care about is profit. If it's salty, if it's fatty, if it's sugary, it is designed for pleasure. That's why they put it in the packages. That's why they put it in the cup. That's why it's packaged the way it's packaged. That's why the colors are on the package. That's why they promote it the way they promote it. That's why they advertise it the way that they do, because it is designed for pleasure and convenience and profit and not for our health. And as long as they keep us focused on eating for pleasure, convenience, and profit, then our health is always, our lives are going to be at risk. Every time we take a bite of anything, we're either eating something that is going to heal us, it's going to hurt us. Food is not neutral, nor are our thoughts neutral. So everything we think is a thought that is going to elevate us, or a thought that is going to bring us down. There are no neutral thoughts. And everything we think about our state and our consciousness guides our behavior, and eating is a behavior. It starts in our head first, and there's a $90 billion weight loss industry that counts on the fact that we're going to get it wrong. That we're going to keep getting it wrong, that we're going to keep focusing on what can I eat and how much of it can I have. Right.
I want to interject right there. I can't help but today when I went swim class, I saw a girl who last year around this time, I bought some of her clothes after she had weight loss surgery. And today she got a promotion at her job. And her arms are bigger than mine right now. And she had the weight loss surgery. And I am saying to myself, as you're talking, she don't have an understanding of her food story. And that's one of my concerns with weight loss surgery and all the other accoutrements that come with that. I know it's not a quick fix. I know it's not the answer in and of itself. Boom, let's go have a surgery. Boom, now you're healed. I know that. My heart goes out for her and my heart goes out for me. And I just wanted to share that. I just wanted to share that. Thank you for allowing me to share that.
I hear you. And here's what I want to say is that everybody's journey is different. Everybody's journey is different. And if somebody needs to have the surgery, I believe they should have it, right? If somebody needs to take drugs, I believe they should have it. They should do it. But the reality is, if you use, they are just tools. They're just tools to get to the end. But if you use those things, you have got to do the mental work too. There's no way around doing the mental work if you want to have peace with food, if you want to have mastery, you have got to do the mental work. And I say that from someone who I took plenty of drugs over the past 40 years. I went to plenty of bariatric doctors. I didn't have bariatric surgery, but I did have liposuction, way too much of it. And when I went for the final time and I did go through a doctor-assisted program, Deborah, and I prayed for understanding. And because I pray for understanding is why I'm here right now. Because I said, you know, God, I can't continue to do this. Show me, help me. Help me understand what I am missing. And as I sat and I went through this process, answers started to come. Because first of all, I prayed and I had never prayed about it. I had never done what I teach in my class, which is the power of the personal interrogatory, honest personal interrogation. You got to ask the hard questions and then sit with the answers. You got to ask, and what you also have to know is that with those hard questions are going to come some painful stuff is going to come up. But that pain will not kill you. The pain will free you. And if we stay focused on the freedom, then we can go down the road. We can move through it. But know that the confusion, the struggle, the uncertainty, the doubt, the challenge, all that means is that you're growing.
Yes.
It's part of growth. And on the other side of it, is mastery. And I'm telling you, if you had told me 5 years ago that I would love having a salad of kale and spinach. Oh, 6 years ago, because it's been a little bit longer. I would love having a salad of kale and spinach and onions and blueberries and nuts and all of that more than I love bread pudding, right? I'd be like, you are out of your mind.
Not bread pudding.
No, that ain't never happening, right?
Right? Yes.
But because I have gone through the work, because I have done the research and I understand what that sugar does to your body. I understand what the salt does, what the fat does, what the corn does, what the gluten does, what all these things that are just in all this processed foods, right, that I didn't know before because I was just focused on the pleasure. Now, when I look at that bread pudding, I can remember when I ate it and enjoy it. But right now, I can look at it and know that it is poisonous to my body. And so I have a different thought. I have a different belief. And because now that I have a different belief, I can make a different choice. Right. And I don't, when I see it, And even if I'm out with somebody, I don't feel like I'm being deprived of that because I see it for what it is. I don't look at it and think that they're having some pleasure that I'm not having. What I think is that, thank God, I'm not putting that poison in my system.
Yes. I want to share something that happened years ago. Before I left Memphis, I stood up in church. I'm Church of Christ. And I, you know, you can stand up and ask for prayer or confession or whatever you're going to say. And I stood up. I said, can y'all please pray for me for my weight? And by the time I got home, my mom called me because someone at church had called her and said, Deborah asked for prayer for her weight. And I said, Mama, she should have been standing up asking for prayer for her weight. So although now we have exercise classes and we talk about health in our most sacred of fellowships, we have that historical thing where it used to not be a big thing if you were bigger in the church. And I think that part of the shame of today's lesson and part of the telling the truth and just saying, you know, my heart's desire wasn't that I am this big, you know, as an adult. And if anything, let's ask God to help us.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
God to help us.
So there are multiple roads that we can go,
mm-hmm.
multiple ways that we can attach this. And, you know, I think that you are right. You know, historically, especially in our culture with Black folk, you know, we're loving and accepting, right? We're loving and accepting.
Yes, we are.
And as we should be, as we should be, because we are all perfect. We are all perfect, but. Sometimes things in this environment get in front of us that obscure that. It obscures it, and we forget, right? And so, yes. So this road that we're on is about getting back to that perfection. But if my grandfather used to say, if you get your mind right, if you get your mind right, and it is a process. Let me say this. And you start making choices about what you're going to eat based on really how you want to live, how you want to feel, how you want to show up, right? Because you said it yesterday, Deborah Ann, you said, I want to live.
That's right.
And so every bite becomes about the fact that I want to live. And if our choices are, we are hyper-focused on, I want to live. I want my quality of life to be solid and thriving and strong. Then once our minds get there, our bodies will catch up. And so it becomes about staying rooted in that decision, in that focus to make choices that support a healthy life. And we learn that, right? You don't just all of a sudden wake up and like get it right, right? It takes practice. Because you know, for 40 years I did it wrong. So there are gonna be some missteps. But in the missteps, we have to give ourselves grace. We give ourselves grace and we missed a step, we missed something because there's something we need to learn.
Awesome.
And you go back and you look at it, what I learned is I don't need to be around them, right? Because okay. they're bad influence, okay. Right? Until I get stronger, because all they want to do is go out to eat, right? That's all there is.
There you go. In that practice, Michelle graciously hosts a weekly meeting where you get to practice, where you get to discuss your wins and your lows and your observations and giving yourself grace. So those of you who dare to join her, she allows herself to do this pro bono. It's on Mondays. So after the lesson, I'll put it in the description so you can click on it and ask her, can you join the class? And those of you who really need a little bit more, she has a comprehensive 12-month support program that takes all of these steps, all of these facings, all of these revelations, all of these stories, and that's a 12 month. But also, she has a writing workshop. Now, that workshop, I don't understand how she even does it. For $25, you can participate several times a month, and it's on a Saturday. And I think I paid, but I haven't been able to make it yet. But I think you spend 90 minutes writing your stories. And mm-hmm. I look forward to that one because I get to peekaboo at telling the truth. Mm-hmm. And if you are courageous, and you are courageous, every human being who is watching this video, you are courageous. You show up every day. I don't care if you're at home on disability. You show up. You wake up every day. You're courageous. And you want to not be in pain so much.
Yes.
You want to little by little pay a note and notice that, hey, I feel better today. So I wanted to stop and let you know that all of this 40 plus years of work that Michelle has put in her own life. See, sometimes you can't teach what you ain't been through.
Ooh.
Sometimes you can, but sometimes you can show me how to walk because you already know how to walk. And of course, she has her wonderful book. But this is a award-winning book, Leaving Large. Can you imagine all that she's sharing in here? Those of us who've worked, who have been around company parties, picnics, functions, y'all know what was she talking about. You know the struggle. And she pins it in this wonderful book, Leaving Large. And that's also going to be a link there for those. Many of you yesterday said, oh, I got to get that book. So I wanted to just share that. Michelle, you have your last words until tomorrow. And maybe give us a peek on what we want to talk about tomorrow. But I definitely will. And as people ask, I'll actually literally inbox them the information so they'll be able to have access with it. The worst thing in the world is when you want something and can't get access.
Yes.
We say go to the website, but I'll copy and paste it because I like people to be able to get the information they seek, especially with this such a personal information such as our weight. When we get motivated, we need that information right away.
That's true. That's right.
Yes.
We need it right about. We need it right away because there's no time like the present. If
yes.
not now, when?
Yes.
And I want to say this, Deborah, and I appreciate you that it is never too late.
That's right.
I am telling you, it is never too late. I figured this out at 60. Right.
Yes.
And I feel better now. My 66th birthday is a month from now, the 25th of May. I'll be 66.
Okay.
I feel better now than I did when I was 26, 36, 46, and 56. It is possible.
Come on, it is possible,
and you deserve it.
All right,
you deserve it. This is what it looks like. This is what it feels like. And I want everybody who has ever struggled, everybody who has been afraid of the camera, afraid of the scale, afraid of the mirror, afraid of getting connected to themselves, to know that there is such joy in this journey. There is joy that is just unbelievable if you will allow yourself to have it.
All right, now I want y'all to put in the comments, I deserve it. So
yes.
I want to
say, I deserve joy.
I deserve joy. I love it. I deserve joy. Put it in there. Okay. What do we have to look forward to tomorrow, Michelle? What are we going to talk about tomorrow?
Tomorrow is going to be so super juicy. We touched on the shame today. We touched on finding your story and facing your story. We're going to take a deeper dive tomorrow in
okay.
rewriting the story. That process.
Oh man, that's beautiful.
Writing the story.
Oh,
and that,
yeah. Oh, that's beautiful.
That's where the juiciness is right there.
Tomorrow, what I'm going to do, I want to ask, you better know it, Porch Lady. I want to post tomorrow the email for those who want to share their food story with you.
Mm-hmm.
And that will only be for Michelle, not for me. But I'll listen
mm-hmm.
to, but we'll look forward to that because that's day 3. So we have We have two more days left.
We have two more days.
My goodness. Yes. These are the faithful ones right here. We have a little family coming on this group, and we welcome those from the UK. We welcome those. Somebody call me from Antarctica one day. We welcome those from Brazil. Oh, my Russian people. Please speak to my Russians who think I need to go to the doctor. I'm like, honey, the doctor can't help me. Please speak to my UK people who have to go up and down all those steps all the time. My Australians who resonate with me. Their message resonates. My Africans, my Nigerians, my Ghanaians, my Canadians. Please keep them in mind as we share these interviews this week, because they have a word and they need that support as well.
Absolutely.
Okay. Well, I'm going to let you say anything else you want to say to close us out. We just appreciate it. It's like you're giving us a hug with this information. You're hugging us.
Yeah, and I want you to know I may be giving you a hug, but I feel like I'm getting a hug back.
I absolutely
feel like that. And I'm looking forward to our conversation tomorrow. I'm looking forward to our conversation on Friday. And you know, together, right, in this community, here's the thing. In this community, we support one another, we move forward with one another, and as we are connected to one another and connected to ourselves, we can overcome this thing.
All right.
We can overcome this thing and reclaim our health, reclaim our lives, right? Oh. And stand, right? Stand without shame, right? Stand.
Oh my goodness gracious. Oh, that's a good one. I can stand without shame. Oh, my goodness. Girl, I might have to pass the collection plate. Oh, that's all right right there. That's all right right there. That's what I'm talking about. That truth sets you free.
Yes.
I need some of that so bad.
Yeah. And we're going to tell the truth.
Thank you. I think tomorrow you need to wear your Wonder Woman outfit with the clown and stand like this right here, like Wonder Woman stands. And so that is wonderful. Thank you so much for our motivational minute, helping us to rephrase our experience so we can tell a different story.
Yes.
Thank you. God bless. I'll see you tomorrow. Thanks, everybody. Peace and hair grease. Y'all know how we do. We'll see you later, everybody. Thanks, Michelle. See you tomorrow.
Bye-bye.
Wow. Bye-bye.